all of the seventh grade out onto the, into the trailers. It will be the seventh grade village, as it were. And she has, have a positive label for it.
Next year, so get my little bill.
To equip the trailers is going to be about $17,000. The PTA has contributed $5,000, and she approached us about working to help raise the rest. We think that this is a fantastic opportunity to begin to work across the cluster with the other neighborhoods to heal some of the friction and divide that occurred during the redistricting process. And we'd like to ask each of the neighborhood organizations to kick in some money. And so I'm here to ask this evening for VHCA to pledge up to $1,500. And just so that y'all know, we volunteered to Paula Harima to help talk with the rest of the neighborhood organizations. And I've already, with the neighborhood organizations that we've spoken with, there have been quite a few that we've already talked to. They all seem very excited about the idea of working together to do this and have committed.
I'd second that.
Well, let's get the motion in proper order and
okay.
Then real quickly.
But I appreciate Rob's enthusiasm. So I move to approve up to $1,500 for buying technology for inland middle schools.
And what budget item would you want to take that?
From, oh, thank you, from actually the grants budget, the grant budget.
Okay, that's something, is there a second now? Got that at all?
Second.
All right. There's a, that would normally be considered in our August meeting under the circumstances, but under the circumstances, I can certainly see why it would make perfect sense to do it right now, to make that money available as one of our grants that a friend of mine who's here often done. As I know, as I remember that there's a substantial VHCA contribution to the original Promethean boards in the building, actually very substantial. I'm not sure what percentage, but it's quite high. Might have been 100, but I'm not, the PTA was part of it as well. But it was a lot. And so this is in fitting in that respect too. Is there any further, any discussion or questions on this motion? Comments from the audience, Wendy?
I was just wondering if other schools that have trailers and need extra money for technology, is that being provided by the Board of Education? Are we the only neighborhood that got that? I'm not speaking against doing it. I'm just wondering.
To my knowledge, each school's equipment is highly individualized in the city of Atlanta. That would, if you're concerned that that's not equitable treatment of all students, I can see why you would be. This will be equitable treatment of all students within Inland, or at least in this one regard. So, in order for the students who are moved out there to have the same sort of learning and advantages and experience, it seems an appropriate thing to do. In other neighborhoods, as Nicole said, or in every single neighborhood organization that we know of approaching in the Grady cluster to ask for support, equitable support, and we are optimistic. Shall we say?
How does it, I know there have been trailers out there before, but how does it affect athletics when that whole field is not usable?
Well, we're going to, I don't know too much that answer, but I can tell you a little bit. I've talked with the principal about, historically they haven't, so there's the lower field where the trailers are, the other lower field on the other side of the fence, and then the upper field area. And historically they haven't really used the upper field area, which has become a little bit of an unofficial dog park. That's going to be used more, she said. It's actually a challenge that they face because there's a lot of responsible dog owners who pick up food, but there's some who don't, and she was sharing with me a challenge that she's concerned of is that with that upper field, the kids come in with dog poop on their shoes and wash it off in the bathroom. Gross. But that's probably a little bit too much detail, but the upper field is going to be used permanently.
How The answer is.
Dog parks.
Yeah, one would think, it's right up the street.
The answer is it hurts them, obviously. We've lost a few, so we have less athletic capability and it's a challenge.
But they, I've been talking to Cecily, her name, they are going to have a solution determined, by the end of this calendar year.
Not a solution to the athletics, but a permanent solution.
To get rid of the trailers, and they're hopeful to have a solution underway by the beginning of the next school year. So hopefully that will happen fast, but I can't speak very fast because I'm doing construction for them.
That's the most optimistic thing I've heard, that would really be something. We have a motion. Any further discussion? All board members in favor, please raise your hand. Anyone opposed? One opposed, Mr. Wolfinger. Motion passes. Is that it, ma'am?
That's it for me, thank you.
I will just add that I thought the meeting was well-run, well-attended, widely distributed, and that one of the, maybe not the specific outcome, but was that the, some of the tone that had distinguished much of the earlier discussion was simply absent when people were face-to-face. I'm not sure that's a surprise, but it was really quite different. Even with some of the same personalities there, apparently the people dealt with each other very, very well, and that was certainly encouraging. Safety first, Ms. Berg. Sidewalks.
Sidewalks. We got a quote pricing on all the sidewalk segments in the St. Charles bundle that we're concerned about. We met with the city on St. Charles to go over their quote and point out to them where there seemed to be some variance. They adjusted it once, we went back through it again, and property by property listed out, Kay Stevens and I listed out where we thought they might have had some measuring challenges. Sent it back to them, they remeasured, and I got those back last week. I think we've gotten about as much from the city as we can. So I've been on the phone with our neighbors, with the property owners. Been in touch with a few more than half. And the others, I think, really just a matter of finding a time when they're at home. So it's been going very well. Response has been really very positive. And I'm optimistic that we'll start having money come in and be ready to put this together with the city. Hopefully in the next maybe 3 weeks, I'd like to get it back down to the city.
Jim, you didn't mention, but did the city say no when they should make the change at your point? Or did they say, can you see anything and say, well, you like? Can you pick up any more help from the city?
Yes, we picked up considerably more help from the city.
How much that was it?
It was definitely worth doing. They were very gracious about it. My idea of tree root damage and their idea of tree root damage was a little different, but that's understandable. But they listened, they remeasured, they sent extra people out to make sure there was more than one set of eyes on the questions. And a lot of the issue really is when there were trees, the trees chewed up the sidewalk, those trees were taken out. Those stumps were ground up, other trees were put in, crepe myrtles, for instance. So it's the city's just saying these trees didn't cause that damage. Well, I can't argue with that. You know, these trees didn't cause that damage.
So they never came around to understanding the ground up stumps from before. We didn't win on those cases.
We didn't win all of them, but we did win some of them, and they were very accommodating going through and saying, you know, this looks like we don't think you're right on this one, but we'll give you part of it anyway. I got a fair amount of that. So I'm actually very pleased. They were very accommodating. They reduced our cost. They were very prompt. They remeasured everything that I asked to have remeasured and got more accurate. They did a good job. I'm very encouraged.
Are they still not grinding stumps or walking the street? Is that the owner's responsibility?
That I don't know. All I know is that you look at the sidewalk and there's a line of cracks going out this way and a line of cracks going out that way, and there's no tree trunk in the middle. Therefore,
you know, we could probably get some help if you really want to get down on that. I mean, I think there's some, I mean, you try to get over and if you get to do that with that, I think there's some orders we can get for you.
You know, I actually think, given the state of the city's budget, they're really doing everything they can to help. And, you know, and I also recognize that I'm not entirely sure that they were even contracting this out. I think they have to come cash out of pocket some for the whole project because of their pricing structure. So I think they're doing great. I think the prices they put out there for us are more than fair. And I'm getting a very positive response from the homeowners and the business owners. So it's very encouraging.
The climate of K2 has left base camp. We will
continue to move. Well done, Peggy. Good luck.
Anything else? Questions for Peggy? John.
Okay, first of all, finally got around to doing something today that I've been meaning to do for a while. I walked up to Fire Station 19 to talk to Captain McWilliams about. I've been reading in the paper, and I'm sure you've seen it too. DeKalb County has been having a real serious problem with their respirator and air tank equipment for their firefighters. City of Atlanta has a completely different company and a completely different system that they use for air tanks and respirators, and there are no problems with ours. So our guys are safe on that. As I stated in my safety report I sent out yesterday, that this neighborhood will be getting a definite boost in graffiti eradication supplies with the grant that I got through the MPU. Originally, I thought the grant was only going to be for $800, and it turned out I got $3,500. And then I went back and I asked for another $300 because I wanted something else. And so those supplies are on the way. And I also made a plea in the safety report for a place to keep all this damn stuff too. And I've had about 3 replies already on offers of places to keep it. So I'll have some place to keep it. Because we're getting so much more supplies than I originally anticipated, and in the fact that we really don't have that big of a graffiti problem here in the total NPU, I'm going to spread it out and share with Ponce Highland in Inman Park, Cabbage Town, Old Fourth Ward, Midtown. And when I talk to Charlotta Wilson-Jackson, City Planning Department, she's thrilled that we're going to spread it out to even more. So that is working out fine. We had a meeting last week of our new safety committee, which consists of Eleanor Barano, who's on everybody's committee in the neighborhood. She knows everybody's secrets now. Kay Stevenson, David Wolfson, Brian Gross, and Juliet White. We initially, Eleanor had come up with a wonderful idea to work through the street captains for the safety team of having some sort of a welcome to Virginia-Highland for new residents. And she prepared a cover letter, and now we're going to work on trying to find some coupons and some other things to add to the mix that street captains can give to new residents in their watch. As to other projects that I had proposed when I wrote up my goals, there is one that ain't going to happen this year. That can be for my successor next year, whoever it's going to be. I would like to have worked on some additional street lighting, but quite frankly, I've never got to it, and at this point in time in the year, this ain't going to happen now. My report, anybody got any questions?
So are you not running for the board?
No. At my elderly age, I am going to start slowing down. I want to do some things that retired people do.
What, serve on boards? Like street lighting. That's a typical activity. That's a very tough activity, by the way, to deal with. And it's an intractably tough activity because it's a huge number. It's got a lot of that. Yes, ma'am.
I wanted to say on the streets side of it, we accumulate street issues every few months and we send them into the city. We got a good response from the city. We sent in a batch and got kind of immediate turnout, and it was in an e-blast. So I just wanted to mention it again so it goes in our minutes. And I'll chase through the rest of the things on that list, but it was a positive response.
I mean, it's the four or five million pedestrians appeared too sweet. Quite amazingly, very enthusiastic group that was actually didn't happen to mention. I just happened to see him putting them in and stomp and how this happened so fast. But they actually were very complimentary of your efforts to stir the pot. So keep stirring.
I saw Waste Industries is now one of my favorite companies. I have a dumpster behind my house. They cracked my curb and sidewalk, and actually I was walking down Highland about a week ago, and the Waste Industries truck was coming out of the CVS parking lot and smashed the new sign on Highland. I haven't had a chance to call them yet, but it seems like there's a wide enough radius for them to get out, but they just ran it. Yeah. And it's
so we don't know who it is.
Yeah, so you can call and say, hey, somebody saw Waste Industries.
I also wanted to ask you guys to start thinking about this. When the old sidewalks come up, we hope to be able to salvage some pavers. So salvaging pavers has a couple pieces to it. Somebody's got to go pick up the pavers, carry them to a spot, and deposit them. And I'm hoping that we can use it sort of as a inventory for paver replacement for people that want to repair their existing sidewalks, and also as a fundraiser, so the association can sell them for a few dollars a paver. But to do that's going to require, you know, a body, occasionally a truck, a place. And if you could help me think about the logistics of that over the next couple of months, I'd appreciate it.
If we just gave them away for free, it might be more encouraging to people to replace their broken pavers. But the Civic Association could just have them and give them out as requested for repairs.
The pavers, the cost of the pavers isn't really a big issue for people who want to straighten them out. They're not that all fire expensive compared to the total cost of having stuff reset. I would like to know a couple of folks that do paper resets so we can make the process easier for homeowners. Because just finding people will come and reset a half a dozen papers. You know, I need some.
There are some people who have been working on my street. They can only work on weekends because they have, you know, like through the week jobs. They have done an excellent job of replacing papers, and they've replaced all of them from some houses. I can get that information.
Great. I've got a couple people that are looking.
Okay.
That would be wonderful.
Thanks, Madison. Appreciate it.
Okay.
You know, the only neighborhood storage area is the driveway that leads down by your house, down Brian's house that leads to the alley. It's a great neighborhood storage. I don't know if it's official or not for papers. Anything else? John? Peggy? All right, thanks. Yeah. On to parks. The first thing is a John Howell Park report that Lauren and I are going to start it. Just by saying that, you know, we wrote a report which is in the voice. Summarizing our efforts today at John Howell, and sorry it wasn't longer, didn't have more detail, but I really wanted a long and complete report of what we're trying to do. What Peter Frawley has drawn and all the changes
There are four walk-around scheduled to look at this, two with Peter, two with Lesser Lights, that's me and Lauren. But, so I urge people to, we'll have them on the website, they're mentioned in the article, chance to walk around and see it. I urge you to look at it. If you can't make any of those, we'd be glad to give you your own tour. We're down there a lot. And I'm not going to go through all the changes here because they are summarized in, you know, a little bit of detail on there. But this is a chance. As we mentioned, we were trying to do two things at once, which was deal with the immediate quality of life issues in the park, the way it looked, the health issues, and the challenges that we does, plus start making long-range plans for the more difficult things, the volleyball challenges, and so forth. So we made a fair amount of progress. We're pretty pleased, I think. The fence work is at least stage one of the fence work has been replaced. It was only several times more involved than we had hoped. Most mainly because of the bamboo. And the bamboo is whacked, and I think we're well on the way. It's coming, it'll come back and get whacked again, but it's substantially reduced and it's getting
reduced.
You
have to dig the roots out.
I will make a note of that. Our contractor will be surprised if anybody, he has dug out a ton.
Well, you just said we whacked it off.
Well, he's done a ton, and it doesn't matter what you do, some of it's coming back. And some of it has come back. And
it's migrated into my yard from another.
Yeah, it's in a migrating state of mind over there. And there's some on adjacent property that homeowners are cooperating with to our great delight on that. So I think we're going to try to make this a permanent solution. Meanwhile, if you have questions about that, we'd be glad to answer them in case we left something out of that article. On to the funding proposal that we circulated to the board and is here tonight. We're asking for $3,500 to proceed to the next stage of the grassy area rehabilitation at John Howell Park. What we've done so far in those areas is treat